All right, good morning, everyone who's here in person or online. We're so glad you're able to worship with us in person or online. We hope that God would bless each and every one of us this morning. We're going to begin with some music. So if you've got a bulletin in your emails, see if you can pull that up. Otherwise, good luck.
God in helpless babe, his gift of love. We confess our sins before God, our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Treasures of our God remain.
Our Old Testament reading for this morning is taken from Jeremiah chapter 28, beginning with the fifth verse. Then the prophet Jeremiah spoke to Hananiah, the prophet, in the presence of all the priests and all the people who were standing in the house of the Lord. And the prophet Jeremiah said, "Amen. May the Lord do so. May the Lord make the words that you have prophesied come true, and bring back to this place from Babylon the vessels of the house of the Lord and all the exiles. Yet hear now this word that I speak in your hearing and in hearing of all the people. The prophets who preceded you and me from ancient times prophesied war, famine, pestilence against many countries and great kingdoms. As for the prophet who prophesies peace, when the word of the Lord comes to pass, then it will be known that the Lord has truly sent the prophet." Here ends our reading. Epistle reading is taken from Romans chapter 7, beginning with verse 1. "Or do you not know, brothers, for I am speaking to those who know the law, that the law is binding on a person only as long as he lives? Thus a married woman is bound by law to her husband while he lives. But if her husband dies, she is released from the law of marriage. Accordingly, she will be called an adulteress if she lives with another man while her husband is alive. But if her husband dies, she is free from that law, and if she marries another man, she is not an adulteress. Likewise, my brothers, you also have died to the law through the body of Christ, so that you may belong to another, to him who has been raised from the dead, in order that you may bear fruit for God. For while we are living in the flesh, our sinful passions aroused by the law were at work in our members to bear fruit for death. But now we are released from the law, having died to that which held us captive, so that we serve not under the old written code, but in the new life of the Spirit. What then shall we say? What the law is, that the law is sin? By no means. Yet if it had not been for the law, I would not have known sin. I would have not known what it is to covet if the law had not said, 'You shall not covet.' But sin, seizing an opportunity through the commandment, produced in me all kinds of covetousness. Apart from the law, sin lies dead. I was once alive apart from the law, but when the commandment came, sin came alive and I died. The very commandment that promised life proved to be death to me. For sin, seizing an opportunity through the commandment, deceived me and through it killed me. So the law is holy, and the commandment is holy and righteous and good. Did that which is good then bring death to me? By no means. It was sin producing death in me through what is good, in order that sin might be shown to be sin, and through the commandment might become sinful beyond measure." This is our epistle reading. Our gospel reading is taken from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 10, beginning with verse 34. Jesus said, "Do not think that I have come to bring peace to earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And a person's enemies will be those of his household. Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever does not take up his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Whoever finds his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Whoever receives me, whoever receives you, receives me. And whoever receives me, receives him who sent me. The one who receives a prophet because he is a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. And the one who receives a righteous person because he is a righteous person will receive a righteous person's reward. And whoever gives one of these little ones even a cup of cold water because he is a disciple, truly I say to you, he will by no means lose his reward. This is the gospel of our Lord. We confess our faith together in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. Third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
That Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Our text for our meditation this morning is the gospel lesson, Matthew chapter 10, beginning with verse 34. While I was attending seminary, I had the opportunity to visit folks at a rest home who were looking for spiritual support. I remember one woman that I was speaking to had a lot of questions about her salvation and was concerned about whether or not she'd be going to heaven, although she didn't really understand that too much. I had the opportunity to share my faith with her and to help her to understand that Christ had died, that he had risen victorious over sin, death, and the devil, and that because of him, by faith in Jesus as our Savior, we had the gift of forgiveness and eternal life. And then I asked her, do you believe that you are saved by grace in Jesus Christ? Do you believe that he died for you and that your sins are forgiven? And she looked at me and she said, I hope so. I have tried so hard. What a heartbreaking response to hear. This woman struggled as to whether or not God loved her, whether or not God had forgiven her, whether or not God would accept her, whether or not God had given her eternal life. She somehow or another figured out that there must be something that she had to do to earn that gift of eternal life. She did not understand that Christ had won that forgiveness, that Christ had won that gift of life. And unfortunately, I think there are many Christians in life now who have that same kind of thought. They have that question of whether or not they are saved, whether or not they have done enough in their life to earn God's favor. And of course, we know that that is so far from the truth. We hear in Paul's writings to the Ephesians in chapter 2, where he says, "For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this not from yourselves. It is a gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us." Yes, as unworthy as we are, Christ's death and resurrection, his victory over sin, death, and the devil, is what makes us worthy of God's love, is what makes us worthy of being able to stand before God and thank and praise him for the gift of forgiveness and eternal life that he has given to us. Jesus said in verse 34, and I think this is what comes as a little bit of a surprise as we are reading this text after hearing what we've just heard. These words that Jesus says, "Do not think that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father and a daughter against his mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law, and a person's enemies will be those of his own household." The Prince of Peace promises division. Promises division on this earth. Certainly Christ brought peace between us and God. By his death and his resurrection, he brought peace between us and God so that we might know for a fact that we have been forgiven and that we have been redeemed in Christ Jesus. But it is those very acts that Christ did, those very acts of giving his life on the cross for our sins, that will bring sharp division between people, between believers and unbelievers. So sharp is that division that Christ uses an illustration of a sword that separates us. Martin Luther said, We must be guided by the principle that one must obey God rather than all men. That is also that we are to love God above all men, above all others. This division is something that can reach into our own very households. For I have come to set a man against his father, a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And a person's enemies will be those of his own household. That's not what God wanted. That's certainly not why Christ came to cause that separation. But that is the result of believers and unbelievers within the same household. Christians realize that they need to give up everything to follow Christ. But that also includes the members of our household that may turn from him, that may deny him as Lord and Savior. Believers are challenged, I think, and can be challenged by their own family members to either give up God, to give up this faith that confesses Jesus as Lord and Savior, or give up them as a family member. General Norman Schwarzkopf said it this way: the truth of the matter is that you always know the right thing to do. The hard part is doing it. The hard part is doing it. How is it that we love God more than our family members? Satan would do his best to strike a division and to cause us to and try to make us do the wrong thing, to love others instead of God, to love ourselves more than God, to give in to the ways of the world instead of standing firm in our faith, to turn to the world instead of confessing Jesus Christ as our Lord and as our Savior. Yes, we are told to love each other. We are told to love our family. And certainly we love them and have a care for them and a concern for them. But we don't love them more than Jesus. When it comes down to it, we don't turn our backs on Jesus, who has redeemed us and saved us. This is quite a conflict that it creates in our lives. And so we may ask ourselves the question, is all this conflict worth it? Well, certainly Jesus is worth it. Jesus is worth it because he gave his life on the cross for our sins. He gave his life that we might have life and have it abundantly, that we might have life to fullness in him. And so is the conflict worth it? Yes. Because from the very beginning, we have been told to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This may even require sacrificing our relationship with a loved one or a family member who, because of their unbelief, have separated themselves from God and have separated themselves from us. The question we ask ourselves is, how do we do what Jesus is asking us to do? And let's listen to what it is that Jesus is asking us to do. And in verse 37, he says, whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever does not take his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Whoever finds his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Well, the truth is, Christ is, in fact, worthy of being first. Because of Christ's humility, because of his suffering and death, we hear in Philippians 2, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Yes, we are commanded to love our families, to love our neighbors, to love those around us, but we do not love them more than we love Christ. Think about Isaac and Abraham. Abraham, we heard this from God in Genesis chapter 20, verse 22. Then God said, he's talking to Abraham, take your son, your only son, whom you love, Isaac, and go to the region of Moriah and sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on the mountain I will show you. And what does Abraham do? But in loving God, takes his son to that region, to that mountain, with the idea that he is going to be sacrificing his son. And as he gathers the wood with his son and the fire and ascends to the mountain, the son asks, Father, where is the sacrifice? And his father Abraham says to him, God will provide the sacrifice. God will provide the lamb. And of course, that is what he does. As much as we love our families, as much as we might love our spouses and our children and our extended family, we must love God even more. He earned that love on the cross. He gave his life that you might have life and that you might have it to the full, that you might have eternal life with God in heaven. And Jesus is also asking us to take up our cross for the sake of the gospel of Jesus Christ, loving Christ above all others makes us worthy to take up that cross. In fact, demands that we would take up that cross. Bearing our cross, now, we need to be clear about this. Bearing our cross is not to be confused with our self-inflicted troubles. Bearing our cross is not to be confused with the problems and struggles that we face in this life. People sometimes complain about people or their situation as being the cross that they need to bear. And that's so far from the truth. That's not what it is. Bearing our cross is giving up everything in our life, giving up all that we have and all that we are, for the sake of the gospel, Jesus Christ, for Jesus Christ himself, who gave on the cross all that he had and all that he is. It is putting Jesus first for the sake of the gospel. Jesus said in Luke 9, if anyone would come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. Following Christ, loving Christ, puts our lives on the line. If you stand on your faith, if you confess Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, you also take the stance that you will also be rejected by people. You will be denied by people. It comes with consequences where we suffer those consequences in our relationships with other people. We will be confronted, rejected, and even hated for the stance that we take concerning Jesus Christ. And unfortunately, we will even be hated by members of our family. The world will either welcome or they will persecute those who come in the name of the Lord. And if we are to believe that Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior, there is no middle ground. It is either we believe and confess Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, we put him first in our life, or we don't. We are to carry our cross. We are worthy of doing that as we do it even in small ways. Our text talks about giving cold water to little children. This really is a reference to verses in Matthew 25, where Jesus directs faithful Christians to feed the hungry, to visit the sick and the imprisoned, to give a drink to those who are thirsty, to welcome the stranger. Don't hear me say that somehow or another we have to earn favor before God or that we have to earn our salvation. That couldn't be farther from the truth. But as children of God, as Christians, this is what we do. We stand firm in that faith because of what Christ has done for us. Our actions, our confession, our willingness to stand firm in that faith regardless of the consequences of that stance. Stand as a witness and a confession to those who do not know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. They stand as a witness to those who do not believe, even our own family members who may not know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And by standing faith on that confession, even in the face of persecution or separation from those that we love because of their unbelief, we serve as a witness to God's plan of salvation, to the gospel of Jesus Christ. We serve as a witness whereby they may come to know Jesus Christ as their Lord and their Savior and come to faith and have that same hope that you and I have, forgiveness of sins, life eternal with God in heaven. To God be the glory. Amen. And now the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. At this time, we go to our Lord in prayer. We pray. Most merciful God, Lord of heaven and earth, we pray you to so rule and govern our church and all her pastors and ministers that she may be preserved in pure doctrine of your saving word, defended against all adversity, and protected from all adversaries, that thereby faith may be strengthened and love increase in us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Grant health, wisdom, integrity to all in authority, especially to our president, our governor, the Congress, all legislative bodies, and all judges and magistrates. Endow them with your spirit and with respect for your word, that they would serve your good measure for the maintenance of righteousness and the punishment of wickedness, so that we may lead a quiet and peaceful life in all godliness and honesty. According to your gracious will, turn the hearts of our enemies that make them to walk with us in humility and peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Grant to those in trouble, want, sickness, anguish of labor, peril of death, and any other adversity, the healthful spirit of your grace for healing, strength, comfort, and relief. Bless especially those who suffer for the sake of your name and your word. Hear us as we pray on behalf of those that we name in our hearts. Give them courage to stand firm in their afflictions and patience until the day of your deliverance. Lord, in your mercy, preserve us from pestilence and every evil. Give to us favorable weather and cause the fruits of the earth to prosper, that we may enjoy them in due season and offer your praise and thanksgiving for all your goodness to us. Lend your blessing to all honorable vocations and honest industry, that we may serve where our skills and abilities may be of good use, especially in this time of the coronavirus, which is causing such an upheaval in our world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give to all husbands and wives grace to live together in love and faithfulness. Bless the homes and families of your people, that they may be places where your name is honored and love is nurtured. Give your special grace to the widowed, the orphan, all mothers with child, the aged and the infirmed, that we may grant them comfort, aid, and protection. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. All these things for which you would have asked of, that we would have asked of you, we pray. Grant to us, for the sake of the bitter sufferings and death of Jesus Christ our Lord, through whom we are bold to call you Father, and whose name we pray, trusting in your mercy and confident that you will give answer to our prayers through Jesus Christ our Lord, who has taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now receive the blessing of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. Lord, make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. Lord, look upon you with his favor and grant you his peace. Amen.